Welcome to the Gardner Museum and Gardner's Museum Silver Exhibit. This is somewhat of a duplication of Ernest Lehtonen's shop, but as you could tell, no two sellers will be the same. But we've tried to go by various pictures that we have acquired from the shop, trying to duplicate what he had. So what we'll try and do is take you step by step through the making maybe of a piece of silver, and this will demonstrate to you the different types of tools Ernest had to use. Here you see a case that starts off with a raw piece of silver in a block form, which is then rolled, shaped, filed, hammered, and polished to the finished product. So as we progress along, we'll try and take you in a sequence that will go from the silver block to the final polished spoon. This would happen for knives, for forks, etc. But this will give you a demonstration of what we have here. The first process would be taking the metal bar that you saw in the glass case, and we would take it through a rolling mill, which would then flatten the bar to a thickness that would be utilized in making a spoon or a knife or a fork or whatever piece of silver he was making at the time.
He would then take the piece out. If it were a long piece and only required a short piece, he would come over to the lever shear. By raising us up, this is a pretty big machine, but we only have about an inch and a half or 2 inches of our cutting surface here. Place the silver in here, and then just snip off the amount he needed. From there, he would then proceed to trace a pattern on it, and then he would go over to his flanishing anvil and then start the hammering and the annealing process to make the pattern become a spoon or a fork. Once Ernest was done with the anvil and hammering to the shape he needed, we needed now to put into the dish part of the spoon and whatnot. So he then would take this flattened piece of silver, bringing it over to his drop hammer, and by using the correct die and the correct punch in the hammer, the bowl would be formed. This is the die for the base of the spoon, and this is the punch underneath. By placing this silver in here and then continually dropping this, this would now give you the shape of the bowl of the spoon.
This drop forge, believe it or not, was located in his cellar. In order for us to get it in the museum, which has a tall ceiling to start with, we still had to bury the base of it in the floor about 2 feet. So you can see this is a fairly big piece of equipment he had to work. And believe me, it takes a lot of force to move this up and down. So we all believe Ernest was in pretty good shape when he was doing all of this.
We're back to this shape here without the bend in it after having been through the drop hammer. So now, depending on the pattern he was trying to follow or duplicate, would depend on how much of a bend he would have to put in that spoon. Now again, if you know, you can take silver and bend it fairly readily and whatnot. So it would be then just a matter of taking and putting in the correct bend to duplicate whatever he was trying to duplicate, whatever pattern or setting he was trying to duplicate. Once that was done, he would then proceed to polish, which would be the last step.
Then once it was shaped, he would bring it over to his polishing bench. And he had a section in his shop which was used for polishing. And here you can see the different type of lathes used for polishing, and with different rags on the end, different types, and each rag almost had a different purpose. Some were for pumice, and a put a finer gloss on. You would use rouge or something. Here he would have, as today they have hoods in a Morrison shop, he would hang a rag off of this nail here, drape this so this would not spatter all over the shop. So once it was polished, I think they would just touch it up hand-wise, and then it would be ready for the person who either ordered it or for resale or whatnot. Further in the corner here, we have one of his lathes that has a little grinding wheel on one side to help shape things up. But on the left-hand side, you can see a little blade. And this blade was used strictly for cutting fork tines. So at a pattern, if you wondered how a fork is formed with the cuts in it, this was done by using this tine blade. Polishing silver is an arduous form. It's also a very, very dirty type of operation and whatnot. If anybody has ever used rouge, which is a red polishing clay, so it takes a lot of rinsing and washing after to clean up after you've done any of this polishing and whatnot. So that basically takes you through what we have for a shop here. We've had a few other, there are a few other tools here that weren't exactly from Ernest's shop, because we have back on the back wall here a pitch pot. And a pitch pot was used basically to heat up the pitch, pour it into a bowl, somewhat similar as a bowl would be made in the glass case on our back wall here, from start to a flat piece of silver shaped and whatnot to a bowl. They would then pour pitch into the bowl and let it harden. This would give the bowl some substance to where they could then take their chasing tools and whatnot, which would put in the carve into these the silver, or punch into the silver, any kind of creativity or design they wanted. Then when they were done, they could just heat the bowl up, melt the pitch out, and back it would go into the pot. We also have another ladle where they melted lead, because many of these shapes of the spoons, bowls and spoons were made out of lead. And once they shaped it the way they wanted, then we could bring it back to the drop hammer and they could form whatever shape they wanted. So if he had to duplicate a spoon, he could duplicate this by making his lead mold here, his dies, bringing it over to there, the drop hammer, and with a piece of silver that had been flattened and shaped to somewhat the shape, continue on and make any specific piece that he wanted to make. So basically this shows what we have for a shop. This was all incorporated in the cellar. We tried to put it back together as closely as possible. And if you look at his workbench here, it's almost identical to what he had in the cellar, because fortunately we have a picture of Ernest working at his workbench. And we try to duplicate the punches, the dies, and the hammers as he had them.
chairman of the Silver Committee at the Gardner Museum here in Gardner, Massachusetts. And we have a little story to tell you about silver and about the silver shop that we have. First of all, here's a chart of the silver manufacturers in Gardner. Incidentally, silver is really the second industry in Gardner, the first, of course, being furniture. Well, it all began with a love affair between a man who sold and was related to William Durgan up in Concord, New Hampshire. He came down to Gardner periodically to sell furniture and became interested in a young woman who was a Haywood. He married her, and one of the workers, it happened to be, was at the Concord silver shop, was Arthur Stone. Arthur Stone had come from England. He knew how to do hand-wrought silver, and he knew how to do manufactured silver. So he was their designer. After William Durgan and his new wife were married, incidentally, Mr. Haywood had already built him a silver shop, because it was agreed upon that he would manufacture silver here in Gardner. This was absolutely a new industry for Gardner. He managed to talk Arthur Stone down to be his designer. Arthur Stone came and met another woman who happened to be a Bent. And she married Arthur Stone. Both of these women, incidentally, were very well-to-do. And Arthur Stone could then start his own shop. And he did in 1887. By 1901, he was selling his silver. He took in men. He was really known for his education of other silversmiths. At one time, he had a peak of 12 silversmiths who did all hand-wrought work. But along came World War II, and Lehtonen went into the war.
The prayers of liberty-loving people everywhere march with you. Almighty God, our sons, pride of our nation, this day have set upon a mighty endeavor, a struggle to preserve our republic, our religion, and our civilization, and to set free suffering humanity.
Ernest Lehtonen died. Emery Pryor, who was related to the Bent family and who was a manufacturer in the Midwest and would come through Gardner periodically, purchase the shop. He thought perhaps he and his son could run the silver business. But he discovered that he was much too busy and that his son, as his son grew, he was in school at the time, was not interested in being a silversmith. He donated the silver shop entirely, which was sitting in Mrs. Lehtonen's cellar, which is where Ernest worked for many years, for a few years. So it was in 1991 that once Emery Pryor discovered that he wasn't going to be able to use the silver shop, he donated it to the Gardner Museum. Look at this beautiful piece of silver. This was donated to us by Mrs. Lehtonen, and it is got multi-uses. It can be used for asparagus, it can be used for tea sandwiches, it can be used for many things. And on the back, you will see that it says stone, sterling, with an L. So he was Stone Silver Company, with an L, for Lehtonen. That so it could be differentiated from Stone, Sterling, Haywood, or Stone, which was after Stone. So the company went on for a long time, when you think of it. So we'll put that back in its case.
Silver has held an intriguing fascination for man from the early dawn of history. Its glorious beauty, durability, and workability ranked it as one of Earth's most precious metals. Its use in the making of articles of tableware goes back as far as we can trace the history of civilization itself. Excavations in Egypt at Beni Hassan have brought to light carefully drawn documents in the form of decorations cut in stone depicting the craft of silversmithing. Actual pieces of wrought silver, such as bowls and vases, that date back as far as 1900 BC can be found in the museums of the world. Probably no craft in America today is as rich in tradition or has such a well-preserved heritage of its trade as the craft of the silversmith. Fine silversmithing is as much an art as it is a trade, and regardless of mechanical advancement, a piece of finely wrought silver must always be the work of master craftsmen. Good silversmithing is a trade that cannot be learned in a year or two. While today the making of fine sterling tableware is more specialized in many steps of its production, the maker must still have at his command not only the talent of trained artists, but smiths, die cutters, chasers, and engravers, each a master craftsman, each a student of design and deft in handicraft. Throughout the history of silver, the quality of the metal has been most important. Pure metallic silver is too soft for practical use. For example, a spoon of unalloyed pure silver would bend and finally break in ordinary use. To overcome this ductility of the metal, a small portion of copper is added or alloyed to the pure silver before the craftsman begins to work it. But only 75 parts of copper need be added to every 925 parts of pure silver. Silver of this quality is known as sterling. The sterling standard has for centuries been recognized as the ideal quality for all purposes, and it is the standard used by reliable silversmiths today. Since 1907, the mark sterling has had the protection of United States law. All silver stamped sterling must contain 925 parts of pure silver in every 1,000 parts of metal. In fine silver has been written the history of the ages, the culture and artistic tastes of past generations. It lasts after all else has gone. The fine sterling silver tableware you buy today will not only glorify your own home, but will become a lasting symbol to future generations of your good taste and love for worthwhile objects. Those who proclaim that the canons of art are defined for all time portray a lack of imagination. There is only one canon of art, and that is beauty. Down through the ages, this romantic metal has been honored and valued by every nation that has left its mark on the pages of history. In every land, the thought of shining silver has always been employed to signify wealth, prosperity, purity, happiness, temporal, and spiritual well-being. Small wonder it has been crowned with the title so regally which it wears, the Queen of Metals.
I'm a silversmith. I'm the last living silversmith in Gardner. It's a tradition that began 100 years ago when Arthur J. Stone opened his shop in South Gardner. He employed anywhere from 12 to 15 men, and he was in business until his death in 1937. I learned the trade from my grandfather, George Erickson, who was an apprentice with Arthur Stone beginning in 1919, and he worked until I took over his shop in 1976. What I do is I make hand-wrought sterling silver flatware. Pieces are made all from start to finish, all hand-forged. There are no machines involved with it. It's not stamped out. It's completely forged, which gives the metal a hardness that you're not going to get in a machine-made piece. What I want to do today is go through how these things are made. Now, I can also say that I came upon this, like I said, from my grandfather. I started in 1971. Just working part-time while I was in college. I went to Clark University. I have a degree in economics, which I really don't need to do to be a silversmith, but anyway, that's when I started, so I have close to 30 years experience as a silversmith. Now, to start out, when you make a piece, I would buy a silver bar 25 inches long, 3 inches wide, and in order to make a piece, I would have to cut the bar to specific lengths. For a teaspoon, I need a half-inch bar. For a serving spoon, I would need a 5/8 inch bar, and a larger piece of 3/4, 7/8. So I would cut the piece in these big shears. Would put the big piece in here. It would be all lined out, so you have a guide on where to cut it. And then you would just bring the shears right down like this, and it would cut the metal. And then you bring it back up and you just keep pushing it in. It's sort of like a paper cutter, how a paper cutter cuts paper. This cuts the metal and it'll cut it to a strip, say half inch wide. After that's cut out, the next thing I would do would go to a rolling mill to get the thickness of the piece I need. This is a sample of the metal that I would use to put through the rolling mill. This is going to be a teaspoon, and actually I would have a long bar that I would put through the rolling mill. It would be a little bit thicker than this, and I would need to get it to roll down to this size. So what I would do is put the metal in here and take this bar and just roll it through like this. And that'll reduce the thickness of the metal. And then you would just adjust it with these gears up here, and you would roll it through again until you get the desired thickness that you want. This is going to be for a teaspoon. I'm going to make a teaspoon today, and what I'm going to do is I want to forge this piece of metal into this shape. This is my pattern. This is made of copper. What I want to do is hammer down on the handle to get it to this shape and peen across on the bowl to get it to this shape. You're constantly checking the metal as you hammer it because you want to make sure it gets to this shape. This way, just about every piece is going to be identical. Obviously, being handmade, they won't be exactly the same, but they'll be close enough to naked eye. You won't be able to tell. Now to start out, I'll take this hammer. It's about a 3-pound hammer. I'm just going to forge down on the handle like this. Silver, you could hammer this forever, you'd never get it hard, but with the copper alloy in it, it hardens them and it lets you hammer it. So eventually it'll have to anneal, you'd have to heat it to 1,000 degrees to soften the metal again. I'm just going to continue on the same process as before, hammering down on the handle and across on the bowl. This time I'd probably like to get down to around here. Usually I'm trying to keep my mind on what I'm doing and just making sure that I'm not hammering on the edge and making it too thin, but it's not getting crooked, things like that. Sometimes my mind starts to wander, then you run into some trouble. Continue on with I'm going to go to a little bit lighter hammer. This is about a 2-pound hammer. It's a little bit easy to handle right down here toward the end of the bowl. See the lines here, how wide these marks are. I'm using the whole hammer. A lot of times when people start to learn, they'll have a tendency to think the side of the hammer, and you have a little mark like that, which isn't really spreading the metal. It's more pushing it out instead of spreading it. It'll take a lot longer to do it. It just takes practice to get comfortable with the hammer. You can see that's coming out now. Off or file it off, you'll get more of the shape. So I think I'm going to have to file this off. File the pieces a little bit closer to the shape of the pattern. Now I'm going to have to anneal this again. I'll heat it to 1,000 degrees again to soften it because it's become too hard to work with again. Checking for thickness, so you use a gauge plate. This will tell you the different thicknesses. And if this teaspoon wants to be a gauge 11. Right now I'm like a 10 tight, so I'm in pretty good shape right there. This is an English standard gauge. It's made by Starrett Company in Athol. And most people use American standard, but when my grandfather was doing it, he always used the English gauge, so that's what I've used. It's a little bit different, but it's something that you can figure out if you have to. To the end, you want to make sure you don't hit it too much on the edge or get your edges too thin. If you get your edges too thin, they might have a tendency to crack when you start the bowl and shape up the bowl. Now, getting down towards the end, I want to this time get it probably to the other side of this hole, so there's only that much left to go. I want to try to start to get this little jog in the middle too, so if it comes out the same shape as the pattern. So I still have good thickness in there. I'm not going to go any further right now on the handle. I want to finish out the bowl, and then I'll anneal it one more time. And the reason that you finish the bowl and anneal it is that you want to keep the bowl soft when you finish out the rest of the handle. Because when you shape up the bowl, you're going to sink the bowl into a piece of lead, and if it was not soft, it would crack. That's why it's less soft. Hammer marks out. You want a nice smooth bowl, so I'll use a different hammer. I'll use what's called a planishing hammer. This is a nice smooth hammer. It'll take all the hammer marks out and leave it nice and smooth. Finish right here now. So I'm going to anneal it one more time and I'll finish out the handle. When it gets towards the end, you have to keep checking against your pattern to make sure you're not getting out of shape or not getting too long. Smooth handles. I can straighten it out and get it smooth at the same time. Piece of metal, and I'll trace around the pattern, and then I'll file down I'll file off all the solids on the outside of the pattern. That's all scrap. You clamp the piece right on the pattern, right onto the piece of metal, and you just scribe a line around it. Outside of the line will have to be filed off. get the shape of the bowl, I have to start to sink the bowl. I'm going to sink it in a piece of lead using a stake like this, just to start to get the shape of it. Get the shape of the bowl just the way you want it. Shapes up the bowl like that. Okay, the last step in making the spoon would be to shape the handle. I would just bend it down into a piece of wood to get the shape like this. And then from there it would just be filing. I'll bevel the edges and then polishing to get a nice bright finish like this. And that's how the spoon is made. And since it's hand hammered and hand forged, it's got a thickness to it that you won't find in a machine made piece. You're not going to bend this. You put it in, if you scoop it into some ice cream, sometimes you come out and you have a bended handle. Well, this handle won't bend on you. And this spoon will last you for a lifetime, even longer than that, as long as you take care of it.
And what are some of the recommendations for taking care of silver?
Well, after you use it, you want to wash it, clean it, wash it in soap and water, and then dry it immediately. Don't let it drip dry. If you let moisture get on it, it'll stain it, and it'll leave spots on it. As far as tarnish, if you use something every day, you shouldn't have any problem with tarnish. Usually that happens when things are put away for weeks or months or years at a time. You'll find some tarnish on it. And every once in a while, you might just want to polish it with silver polish. You can use either silver paste or the liquid polish. And after you polish, just wash it off with soap and ammonia and hot water, and it should clean up nice and shiny for you.
And do you recommend keeping in those little bags?
Tarnish proof bags are good, yeah. If you want, they have, for like a dozen teaspoons, you can buy a roll. It will fit all 12 spoons, and it'll fit nice and neat in there. Keep the tarnish off it. If you're going to use it every day, it's probably not necessary. If you're going to put it away, I would recommend using a bag like that.
Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome. It's been fun.
It has been fun.
Yeah. Hello, my name is Mary Ann Hunt. I'm the museum coordinator here at the Gardner Museum. Just this past week, we have received a new photograph of Ernest Lehtonen. And we will be adding this to our collection here, getting it framed soon and put up with the other craftsmen that are here so that he can be recognized as well. And we love having his silver shop.
Leave your fickle past behind you, and true romance will find you. Brother, cross over the bridge.